It's a bit strange. It feels like being a rock star. I guess that China maybe is the only place in the world where they treat scientists as rock stars. And what I'd like to talk to you today, maybe the most important scientific revolution, computers will become far more intelligent and will gain control of the world.
哎，你那天发在群里的那段话什么呀？就是你发在我们群里的。我说什么？
他许诺对复杂历史的速成理解，人的价值贬得1000倍。庸俗的技术决定论的另一个版本，向一个世纪之前应对昔日之无知尤为有为，未来而亢奋。
A different place.
Sorry for a very tight morning.
Yeah. Can I just ask everybody who doesn't have to be in the room to not be in the room?
Okay. Thank you. Do you feel bored? I mean, so
bored?
Many questions.
Some
you
questions.
You must repeat yourself.
Some questions repeat and some questions are new. So hopefully there is always at least one question which is completely new.
I mean, do you feel surprised that you become so global phenomenon?
Yes.
What's the feeling? You said you treat like a rock star. So what's the reason for yourself?
I guess that I'm... The kind of questions that interest me are now very relevant to people all over the world. And I engage with them in accessible language that the general public can understand. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are other people who are also doing research on similar topics, mm-hmm. but they write or they talk mm-hmm. in such a complicated way mm-hmm. that nobody except a handful of other professors mm-hmm. can understand what they say. And they reach new insights and new theories. And then you need people like me who take these insights and theories and bring them to the general public.
Do you worry about that you simplified their theory, or I mean, you simplify the whole history of humankind. Do you worry about it?
Yes, I mean, this is a constant worry. Mm. It has to be done, because if you want to write the history of the world in 500 pages, you have to simplify. How do you say? Throw away the baby with the bathwater. Yeah. I mean, you have to preserve some key insights, some key ideas. Otherwise, what's the point?
Talk about insight as a medieval historian.
Yeah.
I mean, historian training shape your view now.
It gives you a much broader perspective mm-hmm. on the current and future developments. And if you look at the 19th century Industrial Revolution, a country like Britain or Germany became a powerful empire because it industrialized first. But then a country like China or like Korea suffered tremendously. It was occupied and exploited by the industrial powers. So some things repeat themselves. Every invention, every discovery usually creates new inequality. As a historian, I can raise a warning that it's very unlikely that the new powers of artificial intelligence will be shared equally between all the countries in the world. Mm-hmm. It's much more likely that some countries will lead this new revolution. They will be able to dominate and conquer and exploit all the others in an even more extreme way. So some things repeat themselves, but other things are really different. I would say that maybe the most important difference is that in the past, almost all the inventions and discoveries, they gave people control of the world outside. We learned how to control the other animals, the forests, the rivers, but we never gained much power over the world inside us. And this is the big change that will happen in the 21st century. powers we are gaining is power over the internal world to re-engineer and manufacture bodies and brains and minds. I think Earth will be dominated by entities which are more different from us than we are different from Neanderthals or from chimpanzees.
Do you feel that you maybe sometimes you underestimated the human spirit? I mean, from late 19th century, maybe from Freud, they tried to explore your psychology. And also Virginia Woolf said the human spirit changed totally. But really changed?
You are right. We know very little about the mind and about the spirit or the psychology of humans. It won't prevent us from gaining immense manipulative powers over ourselves. And this is one of the dangers. We had control, we had power to manipulate the world outside. We didn't understand the ecological system. And the same thing may happen with the world inside. We are far from understanding the human spirit or the human mind. And the result may be that we will face a mental collapse similar to the ecological collapse we are seeing now. I think we are facing the danger of the destructions.
Maybe human spirit is much more adaptive than we think and we imagine.
It is very adaptive. That's certainly true. And we see it here that, you know, we still have the Stone Age bodies and Stone Age brains. And here we are flying in airplanes and then living in big cities and so forth. So we have an amazing ability to adapt. But what we see is a process of domestication of humans. We adapt the abilities that the economic system needs from us, the political system needs from us. But we neglect many other potential abilities that are deteriorating. This is what happened to the other domesticated animals. We created cows that produce enormous amounts of milk, but otherwise they are far less capable than wild cattle. Now what the economic system needs from us is to constantly connect to the communication system. And all the new technologies, what they are doing is drawing us out of our body, disconnecting us from our senses, from our body, and connecting us instead to cyberspace. If you don't feel at home in your body, you will never feel at home in the world. My impression is that the number one cause for the feeling of alienation and stress, which has huge economic advantages, but the mental price is very, very big. For hundreds of millions of people all around the world, they bet.
我觉得我不喜欢，很不喜欢那种简化历史的那种方式，简化所有的事情，把它变成几个 point。但更让我沮丧的是，这太庞杂了，我也不知道怎么反驳它，很沮丧。相对于矛盾复杂的精神世界，赫拉利更相信可以统计的数据。他本人就像一台精密且强大的信息处理机，他还试图颠覆长久以来的人文信念。他受到了热烈的追捧，尤其是在中国。
他其实他尊重了古代人类发展过程中的作用。他的观点不就是说，进入工业社会之后，宗教这个故事已经讲不下去了。才出现了人文主义嘛。对吧？在未来简直说，人文主义也讲不下去了。也就是人类需要新的故事来把自己的存在说圆了嘛。
2014年出版之后，什么时候开始意识到这个书卖的真是很好了？
你如果我现在在这说，当时我就认为它能卖，我就想好了，这都是吹牛的，事后马后炮，对吧？一开始推它的人并不是说历史学界的人，一开始推它的人，您猜都猜不到，是创投圈。
我这个好像印象里，
创投圈的广泛推荐，几乎就是无人不谈嘛。所以其实一本历史书被那么多的能赚钱的人或者正在赚大钱的人推荐，那么不挣钱的人挣小钱的人肯定得趋之若鹜啊，说这里面一定藏着什么秘密呢。那实际上什么意思呢？我觉得这个赫拉利的人类简史通过一些似是而非的线索，用这个故事来 强调了人类的协作能力、
嗯、
啊虚构能力、
嗯、
共同想象力是这个人类统治这个星球的一个基本的一个大逻辑嘛、
嗯、
他谈的这个事儿在过去企业界就一直有这个东西，在企业内部应该被叫作为企业文化和愿景，
嗯，
对吧？就这两件事嘛，对吧？
嗯、
但是我买回去看的人这么多，
嗯、
在线知识付费打开率只有15%，
嗯，
其实图书打开率更低，书的完阅率其实可能不到2%，但是他就是因为我有了、
嗯，
并且我知道大概是什么意思，在饭桌上或者在某些场合下可以聊一聊，大家在这里面找到了身份的认同，
嗯，
就是说我们是这一类人，我们关心我们怎么去塑造我们这个企业的共同想象力和虚构能力，我们的企业愿景是什么样子的，然后所有人都在一起用某种似是而非的暗号在对接，说碰一下说我们是这一波人啊，没错没错，对，确认过眼神，我们是一波的哈，
嗯，而且你创造了一种新的模式，
对，这个
这些企业家创业者明明都不读书，然后都喜欢讲宏大的历史，都上来就人类开始演化，
对，
讲就是用一种似是而非的知识把他们都笼罩在一起，
对，
他们也自我感觉很良好，
对对对，实际上是对于未来的这种窥探欲望太强烈了，
嗯，
都希望弯道超车，
嗯，
希望赢在起跑线，凡事预则立，不预则破、啊，就是这大概这意思。我再给您回溯一下啊，
嗯，
它不仅仅是这本书上表现出来中国人对于未来学的热情，
嗯，
从上个世纪80年代这个70年代吧，赖兹比特的大趋势就比美国卖得好，
嗯，
然后尼格罗庞蒂的这个数字化生存，
嗯，
然后到 KK 的失控，哪一本书都是啊。
因为突然在一本书里面挤下了他认为的所有的知识，寻找一个单一结果、
对对对，
单一答案的方式。
对于赫拉利的这种热捧，
嗯，
其实都是这种力量在驱使，他就有点求神问佛的那个意思，
嗯，
就是我告诉你是什么，你就这是你的答案，他不强调
批判性的思维，
对，批判性的思维是不够的，
嗯，我突然想起他是为什么让我不舒服，他某种意义上看起来很庞杂，但他其实提供了一套有点封闭的历史观的，
对，
他不是因为历史本身是开放的嘛，因为我相信历史是开放性，
对对对，
但是开放性对于很多人来讲是太难以接受了，这个事情太麻烦了，
对，
一个封闭性的线对他是很重要，对很多人，
用赫拉利的观点来说，我比较认同的就是、
嗯、
技术的高速发展，
嗯，
它解决了很多就所谓的那个无用之人的基本需求，
嗯，
也就是就像那个超级玩家嘛，
嗯，对，就可以沉迷在那个世界里面，
在那个世界里面，对，它满足你大部分的需求，在你的世界里面可以定义，你可以玩各种游戏，然后你在里面你说了算，
嗯，其实现在已经差不多发生了，
对，它已经发生了，在那个巨大的这个技术推动的这个浪潮下，那一批人就变成了无用之人，
嗯，
他只是负责消费的，
嗯，
他也不创造，而且超级人变得更强了，
嗯，
然后技术的赋权和赋能让那些人变得更强，赫拉利这个事情最终暗合是契合了他这种东西。
倘若你对于未来学的谱系有所了解，你会发现奈斯比特的所有预言之前都有人做出阐述，但奈斯比特的判断更绝对，语言更通俗，他知道如何将杂乱无章的信息拼接在一起，创造一些朗朗上口的新词汇，然后用动情的不容置疑的口吻大声讲出来，他传递的不是思想而是概念，他不鼓励你展开独立思考，而是要让你有原来如此的顿悟。
As a historian, most of the insights you gain by looking at how things changed in the past. But then once you understand the mechanism of change, you can use this understanding to try and say something about the future.
How do you evaluate your own visionary capability?
I hope they are good. I think history is really the study of change.
Yeah.
Historians, their speciality is to study how things change in the world.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's so funny or very paradoxical. You're trained as a historian, but people ask you, like you are a prophet, about future. So how do you think about it?
Now, of course, and I try to clarify it, but people don't always want to listen. I try...to clarify it that I'm not a prophet, I'm not making predictions. Nobody knows what the world would be like in 30 or 50 years. It's impossible.
Now many people read your books, because they want to survive in the future.
Yes.
It's become a new social Darwinism. Mm-hmm. So how do you react to, I mean, their reading purpose?
Well, you know, this is one of the problems of writing books and being an author, that you have no control of the way in which people read your books.
Yeah.
And I see in many cases, like, I write a passage in an ironic tone. For me, it's obvious that this is irony. And I think everybody who reads it will understand. I don't mean it seriously. It's just an irony.
They didn't get it.
And they don't get it. I mean, they read it in a completely flat and serious way. And they understand exactly the opposite of what I intended.
So when you were on stage, you talk about this. So you feel strong alienated from the reality?
So it sometimes happens with some people, and you just have to accept that. I mean, there is no way to write something that people will always understand. You think about, I don't know, say the Bible. So you have Jesus coming and telling his disciples, if somebody slaps you on the cheek, turn the other cheek. And you should have only love for all people. And somehow people read this. And they burn heretics, and they start religious wars. I mean, how, if it's possible to get from Jesus to religious wars, then people can just, you know, do with texts almost anything they like.
Okay.
I mean, again, I don't try to predict the future. I try to point out different possibilities, and I hope that, like Huxley, I'm offering an interesting vision.
Yeah. Okay. Do you mind people call you guru?
I don't like it, but I have no control over them.
Okay. Hope to see you in Israel, maybe. We are maybe planning to go there to see you there. Israel. Yeah.
Thank you. It was a very interesting. it's not the usual questions.
Yeah, we should talk more, I mean, next time. Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Take care.
You too.
比起所受的中世纪历史训练，赫拉利更像一个将前沿科技与宗教语言相结合的现代孤儿。想要理解他的学说与精神世界，最好来到他生长的地方。
爱你中国，我爱你。
来这里吃饭的以色列人多吗？犹太人？
阿拉伯人根本上就没有，但是犹太人
很多
很多。我有几十年的客人，几代人都在我这里吃饭。
当时79年来说，这里危险吗？这里问题多吗？
以色列一直都有问题。到今天为止，昨天为止都有问题。
这个阿拉伯世界的冲突，
几次以色列的战争我都在这里。1982年就是打黎巴嫩。
打黎巴嫩，对，
那个时候打黎巴嫩的时候，很多人，美国来的，其他国家来的犹太人，他们在街上里边等，然后就有车子把他们送走，送到前线去。我问他们，他们我自己愿意来的。
这边也有自杀性爆炸吗？
哦，很多，这个我亲眼看到的。
在哪里？什么样子？
这里，39号。
啊，39号。
这旁边那里。晚上也是爆炸的，他两个公交车。公交车啊，他等那个公交车到站的时候，这个公交车到站，那个恐怖事件引爆，两个公交车的人死伤很多人。他爆了以后，还有第二个人看到你们很多人在这里，第二个人进来爆了。
什么时候爆炸最严重啊？
一直都有，我们都已经怕。
现在是少一些了，是吧？
没有了，根本上没有。
现在没有了，他就因为建那个墙，是不是？
是，
很有效，是吧？
有效。
但是巴勒斯坦人就很愤怒嘛，借这个钱，
把人与人之间都分开了。以前有圣经记载的时候是犹太人的地方，后来犹太人2000多年时候，他们这人就散掉了，逃到全世界的地方去了。以后阿拉伯人进来这里，生活了1000多年，他们也是当这里是他们的一辈子，他们的家，所以我觉得。应该有和平的一点，大家都应该互相体谅一下， 大家互相残杀都不是一个好的解决方法。
哇，这么高的墙，
比那个柏林墙高多了。
对啊，高太多了，这得有什么8米、10米高。
耶路撒冷是一座有着3000年历史的古城，也是犹太教、基督教、伊斯兰教的发源地。
一个小平台，你望出去，居然可以看到两个宗教的地标性建筑物，一个呢是西墙，一个呢是金顶。
与耶路撒冷相距1小时车程的特拉维夫，却是一座引领世界科技的现代都市。我相约赫拉利在这儿再次见面，我很好奇如此复杂的环境对他的影响是什么。
Hi, see you again.
Hello.
Hi, see you again. See you again.
Hey, how are you?
Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. So where to go? We need the car.
Yeah, we are ready.
Yeah. Yeah, please. You know,I just traveled from the Jerusalem, the old city. You see the different culture, different religion, and I mean, very mixed culture, and lots of burden from history. Is there a kind of Israeli mentality? Could you describe it?
As a tourist, maybe you go there, oh, it's very interesting, or you see all the old places, this is where Jesus was, and so forth. Mm-hmm. But you live there, the amount of hatred in that place,it's like a nuclear reactor of hatred. You know, religion can be a wonderful thing, but when you live in Jerusalem, you realize that it can be a terrible thing.
Yeah.
How much hatred and anger. Ideally, a temple or a religious place is a place where you go in order to experience peace and harmony. If you go to a temple and you experience hatred and anger, then this is a dysfunctional temple. it's not working, you know. It's like going to a hospital and getting back even more sick. So Jerusalem for me is a dysfunctional temple.
How this kind of things shape your mind, shape your...
The influence on me, if this is what you ask, it obviously has an impact. Yeah. I mean, if you live in a place like Silicon Valley, maybe you can have this kind of utopian vision of a world governed by science and by rationality and things like that. But if you live in the Middle East, it's obvious to you that you cannot escape this tension because all around you, people are killing each other because of their belief in fictional stories. So it's very clear to you that fiction is an extremely powerful thing. My house, the village where I live is exactly middle of the way between Tel Aviv and Jerusalem. On the one hand, I'm very connected to this world of Tel Aviv.
Modern technology, modern
technology, world. High tech, all that. And on the other hand, very connected to Jerusalem with all the religion and mythology. And especially, this is why I think much of my writing and scholarship is about this tension between the modern world of the 21st century and artificial intelligence and all that, and on the other hand, the still great impact of all these mythologies and fictional stories and religions.
When did you notice the tension? When did you notice the hatred of religions and
I think only when I left Israel and I went to do my PhD in Oxford, then I realized how much tension there is in the place. Or, you know, when you're born into it, you think, well, this is how the world is. Only when you go out, you realize, no, this is not
how the world is. You're thinking about your
为了更充分理解这个国家与赫拉利，我约了几位当地人闲聊。我的朋友王石正在以色列游学，他与我一同前往。
007那个谍战片的这个行业，
对对对。
第一位是阿拉伯律师。
Hi,
nice to meet you.
See ya.
How do you think about the Jewish people? I mean, the Jewish come back, take the city, they become the new authority. Is understanding or for you not?
For me, I don't have a problem with the religion about the Jews. Mm. And they was living here before the occupation. Mm. And we have places that they are neighbors of the Arabs. And they don't have any problem with the Palestinian here. Before the occupation, when they kick them out from Europe and receive them, and later they are get of this country. But after, it's begin the problem. When I talk with the Israelis, most of the people, they have this stereotype. We really feel that. When they talking with me, are you a real Arab? Yeah, I am Arab. Are you born here? Yes, I am born here. You know, here, the thing that it's helped me to live here in Jerusalem, it's how I look. According to the stereotype of the Israelis, I'm not look like the local people. The local people have to be dark skin, not handsome person. And also my accent is good in Hebrew.
You speak Hebrew?
Yeah. Of course, because I'm a lawyer. And in a good accent.
So what's your nationality?
In nationality, I don't have any nationality of any country. It's just residency. If I pass something, if I travel more than 3 or 7 years out of Israel, so they can get the ID, my ID. It's mean they can kick me out anytime. Like that we live.
Do you have any solution?
I mean, actually, I don't see any solution. I am born here and I love this country. I will not pass to anywhere.
Forgot a car. Oh, it's okay. It's okay.
When did you arrive? When did you come to
Israel? 2 days ago.
Oh, 2 days ago. So been around.
Yeah, spent 1 day in Jerusalem and here. Yeah, come here. Yeah. You're much more relaxed than in China.
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah, because you know, in China you run around from here.
Yeah. Too many things.
Oh, it's what nice view.
You want some water?
Yes, some water would be nice.